We're going to continue on from where we left off 2 weeks ago, right? And as you notice from the slide above, we were talking subjective and objective. And it's super important for us to just explain what that means. What does it mean? And today on our show, my co-host, Mr. David, David and I, we're going to hopefully give some more context to this whole thing. If you think of the cross, Jesus was on the cross. If you go too far on the left side of the cross, you'll meet a thief. If you go too far on the right side of the cross, you'll meet a thief. The balance always occurs when you stick with Jesus. Jesus is the one. Jesus is the one our hearts hope for. Jesus is the one that we're connected to. It is Jesus and Jesus alone. And so this whole idea of subjective and objective is oftentimes when you focus on Jesus and you lean too far one side, you end up in an objective world. And you lean too far on the other side, you end up in a subjective world. And what does that mean? It means that from God's eyes and his view, he sees it one way. And oftentimes from our side and our view, we view it another way. And so the subjective is really a lot about our experience. And so in the last 2 weeks, David and I have had the opportunity of just experience a lot of subjective. Literally last Saturday, the 2 Saturdays ago, after David spoke on the objective, he walked right outside, fell down, and fractured 3 ribs in the subjective. There you go. Since that time, I've had 2 of my grandparents die. Yes, I had two. My grandpa on my mom's side, and my grandpa on my grandmother on my dad's side. That's in a subjective world. We understand that there is a world that Christ has talked about. In him, there's a fullness of God dwells. But we live in this world, and we live in a fall, in a world that we have to walk through and work our process. And so the example that I gave the last time, and I'm going to give it again, but I'm going to do it a little differently this time. So let's see who remembers this example from the last time. So to really frame up what it means to live from objective and live in the subjective, it's like this. As a pastor, I also go to work. I have a full-time job as well as an accountant. And at this job, I work for money. Like, I hope you work for money. If you want your job and they say, "Hey, thank you," and work for smiles, good for you. That's great if you work for smiles. When you work as a volunteer, you do work for smiles, though, by the way. When you volunteer for the church, you're working for smiles. But as you're working through, as I work, I earn. And as I earn dollars and cents, it's all on me. But if I decide to say to you, I'm going to take some of those dollars and cents and put them on the table, and anybody who wants to grab it could come and take it, that is a subjective thing. So for me, the start point is I earned it. When you decide to reach out and receive it, that is subjective. The fact that I've earned it, that is objective. When you receive it, that is subjective. If I earned it and I put it on the table and no one decides to take it, it's not my fault. It is your decision to not receive what God has done. So hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on, hold on. He knows it. So I've got a little bit of a, he's already ready to get up on stage. So oftentimes this is what happens in the objective world. So I'm holding in my hand here real live currency. This is real money. It's not real money in America, but it's absolutely real money in Trinidad and Tobago. This is a 50 and 2 ones, $52 from Trinidad and Tobago. Now, oftentimes when God shows of himself, the first thing that you say would be, "That don't look so real. That don't look like our money. That couldn't be God." But it's there. Now, some of you might be like, what is that even worth? You don't know. But you might believe it's worth something. And you might say, maybe I should come and take it. Someone might be smart enough to probably go on Google and say, hey, what's this even worth? The fact is that there is 52 Trinidad and Tobago dollars there, and anybody who wants it could come and take it. I have objectively said it is freely and willingly and liberally given. But anyone who wants it can come and take it. So typically, whenever I do this exercise, everybody's like, it's got to be a trick. It's got to be something wrong with it. It's got to be, is it even real? Is that, what can I do with that money? What can I do with the love of God? And so no one takes it. So we'll go ahead and we'll leave that there for as long as it takes to see if anyone would like to have 52 Trinidad and Tobago dollars. Yes. Yes, so somebody's going to the mission field. Somebody likes the mission field, and he's going to Trinidad. So, Jeremiah, why don't you take a moment and Google what that's worth. What's it worth? What's it worth? No, it does. No, it's not. You did the exchange rate the other way around. You wish it was worth three. I wish it was worth three. That's okay. But that's the point. He got pretty excited. $7.04. Jeremiah has in his possession $7.04. $7.64, right? That's the exchange rate. But in Trinidad, when you take that money and you take it there, it's worth $52. To you, it mightn't be worth that. It's only worth that. And that's often what happens when we encounter the love of God. God has freely and willingly given it to you. But you have a framework. You have an American framework in your mind. And that American framework says, I only understand American money. I only understand religion. I only understand that God couldn't really love me. I only understand that my dad didn't take care of me. I only understand that God says he loves me, but he loves me until my next sin. I only understand that God loves me, but sometimes he gets a little temperamental. I understand that God loves me, but he had to kill his son just so that I could be free. And we have all these warped ideas in our mind as to who God is. But in reality, there's something there that God has for you that's worth a lot more than meets the eye. God objectively says to you, this is who I am. I love you. I care for you. But you play this game in your mind where it really couldn't be worth that. And then you make your own calculation and says, man, God's love is worth $350. And then you get disappointed because you say, this Christian thing was so good, but it really isn't worth as much as I thought it would be worth. But all of that is on your side. That is subjectively on your side of the table. That's subjectively for you because you miscalculated it. It doesn't mean there's anything wrong with the currency that's in his pocket. Dave, jump in and talk a little bit more subjective.
Yeah, so just to mention, the week I preached with Andre 2 weeks ago, I also lost my doggie. So that was a very sad moment, you know. And so we all go through a lot of things, you know, and we have to keep our eyes on the objective reality of the gospel. You know, if we just look at our circumstances, we'll say, oh, this isn't working out. But we really have to see who God is and what he's thinking about us, you know, what he's feeling about us. So this is why we come with this message. It's important to understand, as Pastor Andre said, okay, thief on one side, thief on the other, but our eyes need to be fixed on Jesus on that cross and what he has done for us. So as we go through our daily lives, we face a lot of troubles. Jesus said, in this world you will tribulation, but be of good cheer because I have overcome the world. Even Paul said that through many trials do we enter into life. So We should not be disappointed because the tribulation of this world are not worth comparing to the glory that will be revealed in us. So when we have a grasp on that objective reality, of course we want subjective things to happen in positive way. Of course we want to make a lot of money and our families all be healthy and, you know, things just go very well. But we know that's not the reality of life every day. So we need to be prepared for everything. So this is why this message is so important for our practical living, to really get a grasp of it and have our hearts rooted in that objective reality of who Christ is, who we are, who the Trinity is. So, yeah.
So let's just work through a couple of the scriptures where it shows you the objective side, the part that God does, the part of how God views it, and then the other side, the way in which we often view it. Now, how many of you have ever heard that Romans 3:23 scripture? I think everyone knows that scripture. For all have sinned and fall short of the... Has anybody in this room ever read or can recite verse 24? Put your hand up if you could, besides David. We have two people in the room. If you read verse 23 by itself, it's in a vacuum. Verse 23 is designed to work with verse 24 because it's literally the verse after. And it's literally the verse after, and that reflects really the objective side of the gospel. So let's look at how that verse 24 reads. It reads this way. Being justified, well, actually, let's read verse 23, which is the one in the bottom right corner, and it rolls into verse 24. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Verse 24, being justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption in which is in Jesus Christ. Think about that for a second. You're starting off the discussion. If you start the discussion by understanding that you are justified, start the thought process. Don't start the process by thinking, well, all have sinned, so that's all I'm meant to be, just living from a place of sin. Start the discussion from the objective side. That's the hope. We want you to start thinking from the objective side and working your way to the subjective side. And most of us, from most of the churches we've all grown up in for most of our lives, all we knew was that that subjective side. And we've been stolen. The thief has stolen from us all the good news of the objective. So the subjective says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. So when if you sin, your thing is like, well, I read that somewhere that that's how it works. We all just fall in sin. No, that's not how you start the discussion. You start the discussion by saying being justified as a gift by his grace. So you start off when you think or when you fall into any type of sin, start by saying, wait a second, why am I falling into sin? Because I am justified, and I'm justified by a gift. What does justified mean? Justified is a word, the easy way to think of it is just as if I had never sinned. So when God looks at you, he's looking at you like if you've never committed a sin anymore. Will you commit a sin in your life? Of course you will. You learned that 35 seconds after you were born again, that when you got saved, you didn't just immediately stop sinning, but something happened on the cross. It started a process where you began to realize, you began to conceptualize, you began to become awakened to an understanding that you've been justified. The word justified, just as if I'd never sinned. And you're justified as a gift. And what's a gift? A gift is something you receive and you don't have to work for. Anytime you have to work for a gift, it ceases to become a gift. Anytime you have to work for a gift, it ceases to become a gift. It's now a payment. It's now a whatever term you want to use. It's not a gift if you have to work for it. So our justification is a gift in his grace, and it was obtained when Jesus redeemed us on the cross. Go ahead and talk a little bit about that, Dave.
So another way to put it is that we need to look at this as a bottom-down message. Top-down message rather than a bottom-up. You see, Jesus came down in the incarnation. It's not that we could climb up a ladder. Even Jacob couldn't do that. The angels ascended and descended to the throne of God, but God comes down. The message is that he so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish and have eternal life. So when we grasp the top-down approach, even in talking to people, my evangelism approach has greatly changed. Before, it was stuck in that Roman road or four spiritual laws, you know, of trying to show people how dirty and rotten they were, so they feel so bad they would say a prayer and Jesus would jump inside of them. But really, that's not what was happening. They're already loved by God. You see, he already loved you before you were born. Try to get your mind wrapped around that. Well, you can't, but by the Holy Spirit, you get a glimpse of it. So when we see that we're freely justified by faith, and that verse comes after 23, but in reality, it was before it. We are already justified. We're already called by him, and he had predestined us before the foundation of the world. So yes, we did sin, and everyone did sin because of the fall of Adam, but we are freely justified, and that is the good news. So we hold on to that, and we don't end up with a sin consciousness of always, oh, but I've sinned. But that's not where we're living. We're living from the point of being justified, which is also declared innocent, declared righteous, declared just. Some definitions use it just. Now, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through the Lord Jesus Christ. So being made righteous, being made just is the same. But it is a top-down approach. It's not a bottom-up. We're not climbing up to God. He already came down to us, and he did everything. So that's what we have to grab a hold of and keep in our hearts.
So he did everything, but you got to respond to the everything that he does. He 100% did everything. But your posture of heart has to start from the position of, okay, I'm going to receive the thing that he did for me. If somebody says to me, hey, I'm going to give you a ticket to Disney World, and they hand it to you, and you're like, I don't want to receive that ticket. It's okay. I don't want it. What good is that ticket to you unless you say, I'm going to take it. I'm going to receive it. So it's really this top-down approach is very countercultural to a lot of Christian culture. Because oftentimes you hear words like, and I'm not opposing these words, but when you hear words like this, it gives you a picture in your mind. We're going to press into Jesus. Well, he's pressed into you. We're going to pull heaven down. Heaven lives inside of your heart. We're going to rend the heavens. Well, the heavens were rent 2,000 years ago. And so oftentimes when you think of the two sides of the subjective and subjective side, and you don't anchor your heart in Jesus and who Jesus is, it starts to feel, you end up getting the sense of, well, do we rent heaven or do we not rent heaven? Well, I know heaven got rent 2,000 years ago. It was rent from top to bottom, same kind of story David is talking about. So let's do another one here. There's a common one here. You've heard this one before, this subjective line. This is Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 through on the subjective side. So then, my beloved, just as you've always obeyed, not as in my presence, but only, but now more in my absence, that you work out your salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, both to the desire and to work for his good pleasure. And I just kind of repeat it there. That verse 13, I kind of mixed up my slides a lot there. Really bad. The slides are totally mixed up there, but that's okay. So that verse 12 is really the subjective side. And you've probably heard that before. Hey, brother, you got to work out your salvation. And usually when we talk about working out salvation, it's a lot of dead works. Did you pray today? Did you read your Bible today? And I'm not saying praying and reading your Bible is dead works. I'm saying if your prayer and your Bible reading is for you to attain a status with God, you might as well not read and pray. Because all you're doing is you're digging a deeper hole of religion for yourself. The spirit of religion wants to keep you on a hamster wheel, on and saying, you got to do this. You got to keep working. You got to keep working. Think of it this way. You guys remember in the Garden of Eden? What happened with Eve? The serpent said to him, why don't you eat of this fruit? Why don't you do something so like you could be like God? Do you realize that before the serpent even showed up, they were already made in the image and likeness of God? So what the trick of the enemy is trying to get you to do something to obtain something you already have. They already were made in the image and likeness of God. So eating of the fruit, it wasn't an apple. Some people said, my friend hates strawberries. He said it had to have been a strawberry. Strawberry is the worst fruit ever. It must have been a strawberry. It is still the number one trick of the enemy. Trying to get you to do something, to obtain something you already have. And so it shows up itself in different ways. It shows up itself where I call this group the performance police. Where did you pray? Let me tell you something. When I pray, heaven moves. Oh, really, really? When you pray, it might just get a trickle. When I do this, when I get into this, when God shows up, this is what happens. When I do, and it's a sense of it works from them. And so it's that person you get around and you suddenly feel like, boy, I'm not very spiritual at all. You ever get around someone and you get that feeling where they have this sense of, boy, they're up there. The feeling that you should get when you meet someone who is up there, whatever that definition of up there spiritually is you should automatically say to yourself, you know, I have the exact identical Holy Spirit living inside of me as in that person. Think of your favorite preacher right now, whoever your favorite preacher is. Do you know that you have the exact and identical Holy Spirit as he does or she does? Exact. He has nothing more from God than you do. He or she may have taken moments to cultivate the presence of the Lord. That I understand. But if you feel that you're lacking, you're like, boy, I'm going to get me a 4-week prayer and fast, and then I'm going to get like that. I'm going to go and pray for 3 days, and I'm going to become like that. No. You already have what that preacher has. You just need to create awareness of what you already been given.
So this verse 12 and 13, Philippians 2, this comes right after Philippians 2, 1 to 11, which is called in Greek the kenosis. This is a great verse about how Jesus emptied himself, became a man, became a servant, became just like us, and surrendered even death on a cross, whereby he has been exalted and given the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess on earth and in heaven that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of the Father. So right after that, it goes right into this. So the context is, after Paul is commenting on that, on the life, that's a quick summary of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the incarnation, the crucifixion, and the resurrection, and exaltation, ascension, and everything. So here he's saying, work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, certainly, he wasn't saying, now that he did that, you have to work it out. No, because what he did, all of that was on our behalf. We know from understanding the gospel, that he did that for us. He did what we couldn't do and surrendered his life on the cross and took our sins and was raised for the dead for our justification and our new life. So work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Everyone hears the word work and they think, oh, now I got to get busy, do this and do that. But work out your salvation with fear and trembling. Now, fear and trembling is a Hebrew idiom. If you look at your commentary or do a search on your YouVersion, you'll see that fear and trembling, you'll see many, many times in the Psalms, in the Old Testament, and the Jews would often use that as an expression of seeing the awe of God in a situation. So we are cooperating with God. Verse 13 really gives the objective and the context that it is God at work in you. And in the Arthur S. Way translation, it says God has both to will and do for his good pleasure. And what it says in that translation is, with fear, work out your salvation with fear and distrust. In other words, we have to distrust anything in ourselves that, oh, I can do this. You know, I can pull this off. I can work way in. No, it's fear and distrust. The fear is not fear that God is going to kill us or throw us into hell, but the fear is fear of ourselves trying to do it the wrong way. Fear of the old Adamic way of trying to be good enough, trying to earn it, trying to do enough good works. So I like that translation. It's fear and distrust because it's God at work. He's the one doing everything within us. So we just surrender, okay, and we follow his way, and things fall into order.
That's great. Fear and distrust. I don't think I ever heard that translation, version of it. That's
off
great.
The way. Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if you've probably all heard this scripture, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And depending on how Pentecostal you grow up, but I have come that you might have life and laugh more abundantly. Come. Yeah. Every time I get a Pentecostal accent, it's always Texan. I don't understand why. I don't understand why I do that. Yeah. But here's the thing. For the most part, every time you've heard that scripture, most people would assume that the thief is the devil. Now, is the devil a thief? Absolutely. The devil is a thief. In that context, that scripture does not refer to the devil as the thief. Because a couple of scriptures before, it's Jesus is saying, I am the door and I am the way. Anybody who decides to come to me through any other way but Jesus is a thief. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. That's the context of that text. So what's the thief? Anything that you do to rely on your own self-effort and your own self-will to get to God, that is stealing you from the reality of the gospel. That's the real thief. The devil could steal stuff, but ain't nothing worse than you getting ripped off by your work and your self-effort, trying to climb in to what God. He says, anyone else who climbs in the window is a thief and a robber. Hmm.
So we're the thieves.
There you go.
We're on both sides of the cross.
You're a thief there. Check this one out. This one is one that I think a lot may struggle with. John 14, 20, Bill V's favorite scripture. On that day, we say it all the time, you will know that I am in the Father, and you are in me, and I in you. That's a representation of union that is true, that is objective. That is how it works. You're in him. That day is today. You will know that you're in the Father in you, and you in him. That's how it works. But then you pick up James chapter 4 and verse 8, and you say, I don't know how in that I'm in. I'm not in, I'm in, I'm in. I'm kind of in. And you read James, and you read from the other side where it says, come close to God, and he will come close to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded, you who are double-minded. If you start with this, I'm not in, I've got to climb into God, you will struggle with the one in the objective side. When you understand that you're in, guess what happens when your hands are dirty with sin? Guess what happens when your hands are unpurified, your hearts are unpurified? Guess what happens when you feel double-minded? You just need to take a moment to create an awareness of who God is. You need to become aware of John 14, 20, which is that day that you will know, that day is today, you will know that you're in the Father in you. You're already in union. He doesn't pluck you out of union. You're in him. But when you're in him, do these things happen? Of course it does. If anybody says otherwise, they haven't lived long enough. They live in a Bethel worship bubble. And I don't live in a Bethel worship bubble. I wish I could sometimes. All of you, you go to work, and you go over to the Marriott at your job, and you go to the school system and you work, and you're over at the storage facility. You have real life things that happen, and sometimes it feels, boy, I don't feel so cleansed. I don't feel like my hands are pure. That is your perception. How is God seeing you? He's seeing you as you're in Christ. You're in him. So if you start your perspective of how God sees me, you would see that that would change the framework of how you see yourself. And what typically happens, the trajectory of your sin life will just get to, it will taper off. Because what you focus on, you'll empower. If your mind is conscious of sin, you know what's going to happen? You'll keep sinning. But if your consciousness is on Jesus, what has your attention will have your affection. David, jump on in.
Yeah, so these are very apparently seem contradictory. I mean, if you're in Jesus and he's in you and he's in the Father, I mean, that's as close as you could get. So how can you get any closer if you're already there? So, but to understand, James is preaching to the Jews. He's head of the Jerusalem church, and it's kind of a different ministry. And James is more still preaching the law and hasn't had the revelation of grace that Paul has. Now, that doesn't mean we should rip James out of the Bible like Martin Luther wanted to. In fact, he thought James should not be in the New Testament because he didn't want to accept, oh, look at this, it's contrary. But contrary doesn't mean that it's not a reality. But you see, the greater reality is the objective reality, which is John 14. So we need to hang on to the objective much more than the subjective. We need not to throw out the subjective, and we're never saying, no, throw that out, and don't do that, and, you know, live however you want, and it doesn't matter if you sin, you know. But James is concentrating on that to a Jewish audience. But the reality is what the gospel says. And then Paul echoes that so many times in his preaching. So I would rather camp out with what John says and what Paul says with all respect to James, but he just didn't have the revelation of that. But sure, he did. You can see other verses in James where he did have a revelation of grace. But you have to understand the context and the audience relevance, you know, and then just pick that out and concentrate on that and get all pointed at your sins and sin consciousness and getting buried in confessing your sins. You know, as a Jew, I used to go to Yom Kippur service, and even as a Messianic Jew, and they have this big confessional prayer where you're confessing to like every sin in the world, and it's even stuff you never did. And it makes you like you're responsible for every evil there is. And did I really do that? I don't think so, but I might as well confess it. I might as well go along with what everyone else is saying. But it's just sin consciousness and sin upon sin upon sin. And, you know, within Judaism, they had to repeat that every year because they were never really cleansed. But we have that one-time cleansing. So this is why we have to believe the objective reality over the subjective.
Yeah. That's great. So I've got here, this is not Trinidad and Tobago funds. This is a different currency. Jeremiah looks like he's in running position there. Jeremiah's in running position. And so this is also another object lesson as to what typically happens when we objectively hear the gospel. We objectively hear the gospel, and we have a framework of the gospel, and we say it's too good to be true. So this is £5. Kayla just got back from Scotland. Kayla and Sandra just got back from Scotland. And I said, you got any pounds left over? She's like, yeah, I got £5. And Murat's right there on his phone. There he is. He's checking out to see what's the value of this one. So at face value, it says £5 on it, but it really has a much greater value than the £5 that I see in my hand. And that's often what happens with the power of the gospel. You see it, you're like, that's too good to be true. It's impossible to exaggerate how good God is. It's impossible to exaggerate. We're not going to go to heaven and we're going to look at God and say, man, this is a disappointment. I can't believe I worshiped you my entire life and this is all we got. Man, this I'm a little disappointed. You know, is there any other, is there like another heaven out there? You know, is there, could I get a different neighborhood? You know, like, it's impossible to exaggerate the goodness of God. But oftentimes when we talk about the goodness of God, it feels exaggerated because we say God who was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself, not counting your sins and trespasses against you. God who was in, God who knew no sin, became sin, that you might be called the righteousness of God in Christ. That's how he called you. Colossians 3 and 10, that you are 2 and 10, that you are complete and in him. That's what he calls you. Ephesians 1 and 6, that you are holy. That's how he defines you. It's impossible to exist. We're not going to get to heaven and say, no preacher's going to get to heaven and say, you know what? You should have bought my book because I totally nailed this God thing. I totally nailed it. I totally had it. We're all going to be there saying, man, he's much better than I think, and we can't imagine him better than he is. That's how big he is. That's how great he is. So then, here's £5. And I want to say that this represents a framework that we have. That says, it's only, I have to limit the goodness of God. I have, I know objectively he said he's good, but subjectively in my world, I have to limit how good he is. Because when I limit how good he is, it says 5 on it. It looks like a 5, so it's got to be $5. Murat, how much is it worth? $6. All right, it's worth more. It's always worth more. It's always worth more. So whoever wants the 5 pounds can come and get the 5 pounds.
That's why he sits in the front.
That's why he sits in the front. Jeremiah be cleaning up today at church. So let's do this one. This one I find interesting. Here's an objective reality. Acts chapter 10. He said to them, "You yourselves know that it is forbidden for a Jewish man to associate with a foreigner, with a visit or visit with him. Yet God has shown me that I am not to call any person unclean or unholy." Boy, that messes me up. That doesn't mess me up. And I share the story as to the context of how this works. This is Acts chapter 10, when Peter saw the vision coming from heaven, every four-footed beast and everything he couldn't eat as a Jew was right there in front of him. I mean, it was bacon, it was shelf, it was probably everything he couldn't eat as a Jew. I said bacon, and Ali starts smiling. I think of your husband when I think of bacon. He's so amazing. You tell him when you go home, say Pastor Andrew said he's amazing. I love Alia's husband. He makes really good brisket. I call him my favorite member who does not come to this church. So Peter saw it. He saw that the sheet come from heaven, and he had the presence of mind to say, "No, Lord, that couldn't be." And then God looked at him and says, "You call no man unclean or unholy." That really messes me up. Because here's the subjective side of things. Have you met your neighbor? Have you met your mother? Have you met your cousin? I won't say this because this is good. Yeah, I had some fun times on my trip in Trinidad where I went to give someone a hug. Did I tell a story last week? No, Caleb preached last week. Okay, great. I went to give someone a hug. And this was at a funeral. They're like, "Get your hands off me." They didn't say those words, but they face it. I was like, wait, hold on. I was just trying to give you a hug. And I went to try to give the hug, and they pulled their shoulder and they shoved it away from me. And I was like, it's game on now. It's game on. You just begged me. That was you egging me on to try to find to love you. I told my friends, I told my family, I said, "That person, I'm going to find a way to love that person." And I said, "Could anybody tell me what does she like?" They said, "Well, she likes plants. She likes plants and stuff." I said, "Great. What's her favorite type of plant?" He said, "She likes basil plants." I said, I'm going to get some funds and we're going to give her a basil plant. They said, "What are you going to do if she takes the plant and throws it back at you?" You know what my answer was? They did worse to Jesus. And this is now like the thing that they say in my family, like I've been talking to them. Everything is about, well, you know, they did worse to Jesus. Well, they did worse to Jesus. They did worse to Jesus. And it's my understanding that this particular person, she was living in the same community with someone else. And when that person went and swept the floor in front of the house, she'd go throw dirt back in the ground. That's the person I think that Jesus is saying. So, Paul, wait a second. Give me a second here. Peter, you and your vision with things coming down. You're saying don't call her unclean? Because she was also in Christ 2,000 years ago. She has not awakened to what Christ has done in her life. She has not come alive to what occurred 2,000 years ago on the cross for her. And it is up to us to show and declare and call her and say, your sins are forgiven.
Amen.
She's probably never been told that before. That her sins, and it was so uncomfortable. Her sister came around and was like being super nice to everybody. Every time she would do something crazy, her sister would come around, hey, so good seeing you. So good. Like, oh, it's like, it was so weird. It was so weird. But the objective side of the cross says it this way, that person is simply someone that has not awakened to what Christ has done in their heart. Are they saved as yet? I don't know if she's saved. She says she goes to church, and she goes to a great church and really popular. And she goes every Sunday. She does all the Christian stuff, prays, reads the Bible. She does all the Christian stuff. Every Christian thing she does. So as far as she's concerned, she's saved. And yeah, she acts like a burp, 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 burp. If you're a Seinfeld person, you know that reference. So God says, look at her. And don't call her unclean.
Amen.
That kind of messes theology up a little bit, right? Amen. It kind of messes with everyone because you're like, you don't know the crazy that I have to deal with. Well, Pastor Andre deals with crazy too. I got crazy all over where I got to deal with crazy. But what happens if I begin to see her and call forth who God made her to be?
Amen.
Because I could promise you, When God formed her in her mother's womb, God did not form her to be a crazy that she is. I could promise that. Because God had a thought in his mind about her, and it was thoughts to prosper her, Jeremiah 29:11. It was thoughts to give her a good future. It was thought, those were great, amazing thoughts that God had for her. Is she living up to those thoughts subjectively? No. She be crazy. She be cray cray. She be out to lunch. She be like, man, this is crazy. I said to my colleagues, my brothers and sisters, I said, you know, and I kind of regretted saying it, but I'll say it to you guys. One of the things that we hope to do one day as a church is to do an outreach to a Satanist convention. I hope to do that one day. And here's how the outreach would look. We're going to get shirts that says free hugs. We're going to take water. We're not taking any Bibles. We're going to take water and Gatorade and stand out there and watch people walk in. And as they go into their Satanist convention, hey, you like some water? Yeah, here's some water. You want some Gatorade? Here's some Gatorade. Because they are... Their life says we want to worship Satan. But I know that the person who God made doesn't want to worship Satan.
Amen.
The person who God, when Peter saw this, he is seeing someone who is clean. They're outside of appearance, everything on the outside, the costume that they wear. They're wearing a costume. The costume that they wear is pretty dirty. It's pretty messy. It's pretty nasty. But if we as believers are able to look past the costume, if we as believers are able to look past the outer shell, we can look past it. We will be able to see what God was thinking in their lives. I got tons of stories of people. Chris Valton, he saw this guy dressed up in all kind of goth looking thing, all fingernails black, black eyeball, black, all that stuff. And God said to Chris, this young man has a creative gift, and the reason why he's this way is because he got mad with God at this time of his life, and I want to do something in his life. Chris turned and said, hey! And Chris started giving him the prophetic word. That guy received that prophetic word. He connected his heart with the Lord. What would have happened if we only looked at the outside appearance and just looked at the costume that was presented in front of him? He would have missed his opportunity. Don't be scared of the costume. Don't let the costume that people wear scare you away. Because inside of them is something great that Jesus wants to talk about. Go ahead, David.
Yeah, so this was very radical when Peter had this vision. I mean, for a Jew to then go to the Gentiles, this was, I mean, like a blasphemy for the religious Jews. I met a Hasidic couple from New York through business, and I met the wife many years ago in Atlanta and went to shake her hand, and she pulled away. So apparently the women aren't allowed to have a physical contact at all with a man or a non-Jewish man. I mean, I'm Jewish, but not any man, I think, other than their husband. You know, she had the thing on her head and everything. Very nice lady, ended up knowing her, doing some business later. But the point is, in that day, this was like unheard of, you know. And when a Jewish man, he goes in a trance and he's hungry, he's going to think about what? He's going to think about brisket and roast beef and corned beef and knishes and whatever, you know. But bacon and shrimp, no way. So this was scandalous. You know, but Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, we now regard no one after the flesh. We even used to regard Christ that way, but do so no longer. If anyone's in Christ, he's a new creation. New. Everything's new. Nothing's old. Everything's new. So from God's standpoint, that guy you see on the street corner or that crazy person you run into or your neighbor, they're already in Christ. Am I saying they're saved? Am I saying they have a revelation of Jesus? No. They may not. But from God's point of view, from the objective point of view, he has included them. He sees everyone included. God does not exclude. He's not counting. You know, that's Calvinism. This one's in, this one's out, this one's in. So nobody knows really who's saved. And if you're out, well, there's no chance to get in, so you might as well give up. And if you're in, you got to maybe keep doing good works to hope you're in. But there's really no hope, no assurance with that. So the point is that we regard no one after the flesh. I had a conversation with a guy last week, and he had all kind of crazy things. He said, like, he believes there's two different gods, Old Testament and New Testament. But I can see where he gets that, because if you just read the Old Testament, you read the New without any understanding, and then you listen to some prophetic guy with crazy stuff, some Italian guy, I don't know the name, and all kinds of things that, oh, so many things in the Bible are wrong, and the words are wrong, and I try to explain to him a few words in Greek and Hebrew and all that, but I couldn't get through to him. But I just let him talk, and I heard after a while he explained how he had a dream about Jesus. So, you know, God is working at some in some level in him. And then later in the week, he came over to me again. So, you know, just developing a rapport. So I see, like, meeting people on their level and just letting them talk. You know, don't be hitting them with the four spiritual laws, you know. So we have to go gradual, meet people on a level, and see that they were included, whether they didn't know it or not, or believe it or not, you know. And I told them, hey, you know, you may not know it, but you're included in the life of Jesus Christ. So he just kind of gave a look. He didn't say yes or no, but, you know, he did come back to talk a couple of days later, you know, and I didn't seek him out. He came to me, so we were kind of developing a rapport in that. That was at work, actually. So the point is, we have the objective, how God sees everyone, and Paul wrote that we need to see everyone in that way. And Peter had that vision. He was the first to get that revelation, that call no one unclean. God made them. In Acts 17, Paul went to the pagans, the Greek philosophers, and said, in him you live and move and have your being, even as your pagan philosophers have said. So he took from their poetry and showed them that they are known by God. So we are, everyone is included, so we need to see people the way God sees them. So that's the story of clean and unclean. And you know, in the Old Testament, they had the kosher and unkosher and all the different laws, but that was just to meant a differentiation. But this was God doing away with it and declaring all foods clean. And now we can eat bacon and say hallelujah.
All right, so we've gone pretty long. The people next door, the rules are when 7 o'clock come, they could start putting their music on for their parties. So that's why you're hearing music next door. Last time there was a mariachi band and I felt like having tacos as soon as the service over. So I've got the microphone here. Does anybody have any questions? We want to make sure this is, Jeremiah's here. He took our money and he's having questions. Okay, come, Jeremiah, ask some questions. Yeah, don't stand in front of the speaker. Just come this way so we don't doesn't get feedback. There you go.
Yes. Hello?
Can we put mic number one on, please? The green is on. It should be on. Mic number one. Just so we could get it for the video next time. All right. So go ahead. You just speak in the mic and then they'll eventually get it on.
Okay. So I was... Hello?
It's okay. When they figure it out, then you'll be able to, it'll get into the recording. I just want it to be in the recording. So just keep your hands in front of mine.
So when it comes to repentance, mm-hmm. What is the proper way to look at it?
Oh, perfect. That's a great question.
Yeah.
Excellent question.
Because sometimes I even get caught up in like repenting like daily.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just curious.
Excellent question. Okay. Excellent. What's the proper thing repenting? So oftentimes the word repentance is conflated with the word confessing, right? It's often been used interchangeably in most of the Christian churches that he grew up with. The word repentance and the word confession are interchangeable words. They are not interchangeable. They are very, very different terms. The word repentance comes from a Greek word metanoia, which means to change the way you think. Change the way you think. So when you say, I go and I repent, if you didn't actively change the way you think, you didn't really repent. I could repent from McDonald's and repent toward Burger King. You could repent from one thing. I changed the way I think about McDonald's, and I've showed the way I think about Burger King. Repenting from. So the word repentance means turn, go around, pent, top floor of a building. So change the way you think. So the word confession simply means to say what somebody else has said. It comes from the Greek word homologio, homo meaning same, to say what someone else has said. So if you think of 1 John 1:8, what has Christ said about your sin? He has said that your sin has been not been counted against you. So when you, if you feel like there's a need for daily repentance, or better said, a need for daily confession, then you should say about your sin what God says about your sin. That's what you need to, if you feel like that, but here's what God says about your sin. Took care of it 2,000 years ago.
Yeah.
That's what he said. Took care of all of it 2,000 years ago. So I have no problem with someone saying, if after they've sinned, God, I thank you, you took care of this thing 2,000 years ago. I'm so grateful. Because you're not going to say, God, I'm asking you now to forgive me of this sin now. Because that means you are doing a work to attain something from God. The real work is thanking God for what he did 2,000 years ago. It's a real paradigm shift. It's a real paradigm shift. So, and that's a common thing, and that, what you're describing is not uncommon. It's a kind of leftover from the old 1600 years ago when Luther came and he just kind of put all the tables upside down. Because what would happen was that people would sin, and they would go to a temple, and they would get their sin taken care of. And then what they would also do is that if they know that spring break is coming up, or they know that they have a binge to go on, they know that they want to go binge drink or binge drugs or binge something, they would go to the temple and they would buy an all-purpose pack of indulgences. That's a real thing. It was called an indulgence. You would buy indulgences from the church. And you know that once, so I bought me a night out of the town, this amount of drugs, and so I know that God's taking care of that sin because I already paid for it already. This is just a leftover from that, what you think, what you're talking about. So when we talk about the gift of God is freely given to man, you know, so so you know, Kayla and Sandra just went to Scotland. They have these cathedrals that they've built. They're beautiful cathedrals. Do you know how they built those things? With sin money. Because think about it. If that's the sin, listen, if we wanted to get our church building together, you know how fast we could build our building if I sold indulgences? I say, listen, you want to go binge drink tonight after church? I'm going to need $500. And your sins are already forgiven. Go take care of. Man, I would clean up. We would clean up. And as you think about it, as you think of how the churches run, many churches are run today, there's a lot of, hey, if you do this, if you sow into this, God's going to give you this. Yes, I believe in sowing and reaping, but a little bit smells of indulgences sometimes. And so I'm often very careful of that. I should have said that. I want to honor ministers who do it the right way, right? Because they're not everyone does it the wrong way. Yeah. But yeah, that's a very good question. Did I answer it? Wonderful. Anybody else got a question?
Let me just say that the word repentance was kind of hijacked from its real Greek meaning by the Roman Catholic Church when they, in the Latin Vulgate, and they took the word penance, so that's why repentance. So penance from the word penance, you know, when you confess your sins, and then you have to do this and this and this to absolve yourself, and then keep doing it over and over again. So that's where it got twisted, the definition. So a lot of people don't understand that and get caught in that. But if you feel a need to repent from sin, you know, to confess sins, it's fine as long as you're not confessing to gain anything, to gain salvation, but you're confessing because they're already forgiven, and you're thanking God, and you're declaring, you're agreeing, homologia, the same as what he said, that he's already taken them away. So in that aspect, the confession is good. Yeah.
Great. I'm going to take two more questions. Kayla, I know you had a question. This is the other Kayla, by the way.
Do you believe everyone is included in the objective part of the gospel?
Yes. It's an easy question. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Easy question. Yes, that was easy. Everyone's included. Has everyone awakened to their inclusion? No. I just asked asked that lady I was dealing with in Trinidad. She's far from awakened to inclusion. She is a little bit, she's way outside of how, yeah. She's fast asleep. She's taken 50 NyQuils when it comes to her inclusion. Yes. The biblical text for that is the one I just quoted, right? Is that God was in Christ reconciling only in Countess Church members. All right, let's try it again. God was in Christ reconciling only the people that voted like me. Okay, let's try one more time. God was in Christ only reconciling people who are not vegan. No, I'm just kidding. No, God. God was in Christ reconciled. The Bible says the world, the Greek word is the word cosmos. He's reconciled everyone to himself, not counting their sins and trespasses against them. That's objective. Objective. Subjectively, somebody's got to figure it out. You've got to decide, I am taking this goods. Dave. Well,
yeah, we have to get in. We need to get that in our heads, because the sin problem is taken care of, but most churches are just preaching sin and sin and sin to get members to come to the altar every week and get Jesus to jump in you and then jump out of you by Monday night and back in. And it's a yo-yo. I call it the roller coaster of religion, or the yo-yo, or the donkey and the carrot, you know, or the hamster wheel, and it's just round and round and round we go and back to the altar. So the altar is fine to go to, but we need to receive this abundance of grace and gift of righteousness. Let's let Kimberly ask her question.
Yeah, I don't know, has anyone in your history, this is my history, that you grew up in a church environment where you got saved at least 64 times? All right, 1, 2, 3, 4. All right, you got saved 64 times. Because there's always, millions have come, but there's still room for one.
Right.
There's room at the cross for you.
I remember one woman and every week. And then I went to another church and she showed up there and back to the altar, getting saved again.
When were you saved? Really, 2,000 years ago, when did you realize you were saved? Today you went down by the altar. Objective, subjective. Subjective, subjective. Right? It's true to say that 2,000 years ago, you were there. Galatians 2:20 puts it this way, I am co-crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but Christ lives in me. That's another translation. Kimberly, question. Here's the stomp. Here's going to be the stomper.
So I know people who say, oh, like, we sin every day, yes, right? And then there's people that say, oh, I have to repent every single day. But
yes,
do you honestly believe that that's a healthy Christian mindset, to be throwing yourself on a rock every single day saying, I have to repent. Oh, no, I did this again. Like, is that a healthy Christian mindset?
No, I don't, because here's the problem with that. What about the sins you forgot about? So, or do you just do a blanket, like it's like blanket insurance? Like, I repent for the ones that this is what we would, like, Father G, now I lay down to sleep. I repent for my sins known and unknown. Anybody ever pray that prayer? One person. All right, so we got a couple people. I repent for the sins known and unknown.
Yeah.
You have the just in case prayer. Let's for those of you that have lived like that, does it feel like bondage?
Yeah.
It feels like bondage, because you ever been in a, here's the worst. You're doing something in your day and you see a car coming really fast behind you, and they look like they're gunning it, and the way it looks, you could very well get in an accident the way in which these cars are driving. What's your first thought? Jesus, I repent. In case that guy kills me, I want to make it happen. Focus and get out of the way.
You know, you heard about the religious Catholic that went and he goes to confession, and he's clean, and he comes out, he has a bad thought, he gets hit by a car, and did he go to hell? I mean, that's crazy. So the thing is, also about that mindset, is that we're putting it back on ourselves. It's all up to us. We got to do it. We got to do it. And if we forget, oh, we're in trouble. Now we forgot, you know. And as Andre said, maybe some sin we forgot, you know. It skipped our mind. So, but we don't want to put it back on ourselves, because Jesus already did it. He took care of it.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Am I saying that you should not? You can do whatever you want. You have freedom in Christ. But what has happened to the sin? It got taken care of. It got taken care of. It got taken care of. All right. So it's let's stand together. Let's stand together. If you had a question that I didn't get to answer, because it's 7:24. If you had a question that you get to answer, feel free to ask Jeremiah because he has all the money. The apostle. Yeah, we're trying to build a relational community here. And the New Covenant looks more like a table than it looks like a stadium. The New Covenant Church. And so we want to hash these things out. And oftentimes I might give, lucky today I had the answers. There are days that I don't have the answers. But it's okay. It's okay. So Father, thank you that we're in you. We're in you. We're in Christ. Just take a moment to create some awareness of that in Christ's nature. And if you have sin to confess, say what Jesus has said about it. But realize that it's not an issue. Realize that it's already dealt with. And thank God for the way he already dealt with it. He's completely dealt with all of your sin. I'm going to say what Jesus said about my sin, that they're forgiven. I'm going to say what Jesus said about me. I'm clean. I'm going to say what Jesus says about me. I'm whole. I'm going to say what Jesus says about me, that I've been baptized into his goodness, baptized into his love. I've been baptized into him, and I've been raised to newness of life. Romans 6:3. So I live from that place in Romans 3, where I've been justified by his grace. I live from that place where it is Christ at work in me. I live from that place where that day I'm in the Father in me, and I in you. I'm living from that place. And as I live from that place, my reality changes. I don't live in a place of bondage. I'm not bound to a treadmill of confession because my sins are already forgiven. And I get to make that declaration to others. Like John 20:23 says, we get to say your sins are forgiven because it happened 2,000 years ago. Amen. And as you make that declaration, as you share the gospel, you would see the light bulbs go off. Thank you, God, for what you're doing. In Jesus' name.